Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. First of all, we would like to thank Ed Calabrese for the invitation to be here in Amherst. And a show was suggested that we would give a show, a more or less scientific show, and the first thing that happened is that the computer broke down. So that's the first part of the show, that is some promise. The title is Adaptation to Reactive Intermediate, but not as we know it. And Jaap, this is a very enigmatic title that has some familiar sound to me, but I really do not understand it fully, the impact of the title.
Well, Aalt, the title, obviously, I'm not sure if people catch this, but it refers to, of course, Star Trek, the famous Dr. Spock, its life gem, but not as we know it. And of course, in this case, we're going to have time, but not as we know it. So that's sort of the Trekky background we sort of try to infuse in this title. So.
But yeah, the Star Trek was, of course, a very, let's say, clean society. Everything was possible. Everything is there. And in real life, you're a chemist. And you might wonder if it is really true that we as human beings are, in fact, live in a very hostile environment from a chemical perspective.
As a chemist, I'm a chemist by trade, and I've worked with Aalt for the last 16 years. And I'm sort of tainted with toxicology, you might say. I think, yes, we do live in an environment which might be regarded as hostile, and we usually do that. And of course, food is the primary example of this, so to speak, hostility. And most of the chemicals we're exposed to are, in fact, through food. So it's important and interesting, especially as a chemist and a toxicologist, to take a look at the wide variety of chemicals we are exposed to. And the next example is, for instance, methyl bromide, which we know as a pesticide used in agriculture. But strangely enough, we'll see this compound also found in regular foods and at levels which are not really that something to worry about, but nevertheless measurable. And of course, methyl bromide is a well-known carcinogenic. And we find it everywhere in the soil and higher plants. And these are a few examples we might consume on a regular basis. Another example, I've drawn a few chemicals here. I'm not sure if people recognize these chemicals related to a certain product we consume all over the world, especially in the Netherlands. We really enjoy the material we drink every day containing these kinds of chemicals. And of course, I'm talking about coffee. And of course, this is a very beautiful example of how you extract a good espresso. The tiger stripes indicates that you have done your proper grinding, your proper pressure, and this looks very, very nice. Now, all these chemicals, take benzopyrene, very well-known chemical, is biotransformed. And this biotransformation, essentially, is related to the idea that you want to move from the lipophilic to the hydrophilic in order to facilitate renal excretion. Now, how do we, and basically any kind of material in the world, plant material, organic material, live material, how do we do that? Well, with, of course, the heme protein cytochrome P450. And it utilizes, sort of ironically, oxygen toxicity to oxidize a toxic lipophilic compound. And this is the general process depicted here. So we are talking about a not always successful, I might say, slow adaptation to toxic compounds, here related specifically to P450. So Aalt is a toxicologist. You undoubtedly have examples of a more rapid adaptation to xenobiotics. And I'm interested how you view that.
Yeah, I think we have various examples. This is an example that we did research on this compound for a very long time. There's the biotransformation of the compound orphanodrin, an anticholinergic, antihistaminergic compound. And as you can see, it is demethylated and demethylated. The methyl group is removed, stepwise fashion. Then the total demethylated compound occurs. But in the meantime, also a reactive metabolite is formed, is an N-oxide. And the N-oxide is a reactive compound, a reactive metabolite, a reactive intermediate. And this reactive intermediate may interact with your cytochrome P450, the enzyme that you indicated, because it gives a complex to the heme iron of cytochrome P450. There's an irreversible complexation to the heme iron of cytochrome P450. And in that way, it complexes the P450, and it inhibits the P450 activity. You can see that here, because these compounds give a very peculiar and very specific complex, an absorption at 455 nanometers, and is indicative for an interaction of these nitroxide radicals, these intermediates, with the cytochrome P450 heme iron. And especially if you come closer to the compound that is giving this complex, for example, the N-hydroxyl compound, that is an intermediate form in the demethylation of orfenadrin. And indeed, the N-oxide, that is probably the compound, the reactive intermediate that gives this irreversible complex to cytochrome P450. Not only orfenadrin, but also, you can see that here, the compounds related to orfenadrin, the metabolites of orfenadrin, and you see the more closer you come to this N-oxide, the more active the 455 nanometer complex formation occurs. Metabolic intermediate complexation of cytochrome P450. It even has some impact on the pharmacokinetics of orfenadrin, for example. If you do, for example, single-dose kinetics with this compound, and you measure all the pharmacokinetic data and the parameters of orfenadrin, you can predict what would be the steady-state concentration after a multiple dose of orfenadrin. And in fact, if you do that, you calculate the steady-state concentration of multiple dose based on the single-dose kinetics. This is to calculate the steady-state concentration depending on the dose. But in real life, you see that the concentration of orfenadrin becomes much higher. Why? Because you have this complex formation. The reactive metabolite inhibits its own formation, thereby inhibiting the biotransformation of orfenadrin. And in fact, in real life, orfenadrin concentration increases in the plasma of human. So that means that there is an inhibition of its own formation. The reactive metabolite inhibits its own formation. It's not only orfenadrin that is doing that. For example, also the well-known compound nefepam, a painkiller, non-opioid structure, as a painkiller, very effective, also gives this 455 nanometer complexation. And not only that, also in the food, you gave an example for it. For example, take the compound safrole. Safrole present in nutmeg, cinnamon, mace, anise, black pepper. All these material contain safrole. And safrole, this compound, is epoxidized by the cytochrome P450 enzyme system, giving rise to the epoxide, which is indeed also a very reactive, damaging, toxic compound that is a result of eating safrole. And it's not only the epoxide, but all other compounds occur out of safrole. For example, this compound, after the hydroxylation by cytochrome P450 of safrole, sulfation occurs, sulfate goes out, and you have this carbocation, which is very reactive towards thiols, for example, also a toxic metabolite. And also here, the safrole, oxidation by cytochrome P450, this leads to the quinone form. The quinone is in equilibrium with the quinone methide, and this redox cycles. And in this redox cycling system, reactive oxygen species occur, which may lead to damage to organ systems, to cells. So all these metabolites of safrole are in fact very reactive metabolites. Luckily, one of the metabolites of safrole is a carbene. And this carbene is a compound that is also formed out of safrole. And this carbene interacts again with the iron out of cytochrome P450, directly inhibiting the cytochrome P450, all the isoenzymes of cytochrome P450 are inhibiting, and that way safrole inhibits the formation of all these reactive metabolites. So it prevents the formation of reactive metabolites by itself, safrole. Do you like my examples, Jaap? So apparently a rapid inhibition by these reactive, potentially toxic metabolite, and they inhibit their own formation.
That's interesting. But I'm not quite sure yet. Please, I think I'm missing the point here, because you showed, as a chemist, of course, I'm really interested in this, a rapid adaptation because of immediate substrate enzyme product covalent bond forming. The moment it is formed, it reacts immediately with the enzyme and actually blocks the enzyme from actually performing its duty. So I'm not quite convinced yet, but let's go back to benzopyrene. This is a paper written in 2014 in Nature, which shows the complex dance of chemicals between the benzopyrene and its oxidation towards its more hydrophilic compound. I'm not going to explain everything on this, but I will highlight a few points from this part. First, the biotransformation requires a few precursory steps. And one thing is at least that the unligated aryl hydrocarbon receptor, AHR receptor, resides in the cytoplasm of the cell. And once it is bound to the benzopyrene, the AHR complex translocates to the nucleus where it actually binds to DRE parts of the DNA. And this particular process kicks in the gene expression of cytochrome P450 that will actually transform the benzopyrene in a number of steps of reaction I just showed you. So this is sort of a time frame, or another time frame where you discuss, Alt, where you see an adaptation to an sort of a toxicological insult of a certain chemical found in a product I very much like, which is coffee. So in time, induction of an important biotransformation enzyme like P450 is an important coping mechanism. In other words, not as fast as you suggest, Alt. I need the bigger picture here.
Now, there's another thing. Perhaps I can convince you in that respect, because cytochrome P450 is located in the endoplasmatic reticulum of, for example, a liver cell. That is cytochrome P450. If these reactive metabolites are further detoxified by enzymes also present in the endoplasmatic reticulum, and that is the case, endoplasmatic reticulum in the hepatocyte, cytochrome P450 is present, but also a further detoxifying enzyme is present there. For example, this enzyme, glutathione S-transferase. It conjugates glutathione to reactive metabolites, thereby detoxifying these reactive metabolites. Take, for example, acrolein, alpha-beta unsaturated aldehyde. It directly reacts with thiols, and this reaction with glutathione, and this reaction is activated by the microsomal glutathione S-transferase. In fact, a compound like acrolein activates even the glutathione S-transferase. So these reactive metabolites, thiol reactive metabolites, they activate the enzyme system that detoxifies them. So that's beautiful. And not only acrolein is doing that, just to give you an example, we did some work a long time ago with, for example, the compound N-ethylmalleamide. N-ethylmalleamide also reacts with a thiol group, and that by it conjugates, the thiol group conjugates to the N-ethylmalleamide. This compound by itself is thiol reactive, so it activates the glutathione system. Look, for example, here. This is the basal activity of glutathione S-transferase in the microsomal membrane, so in the endoplasmatic reticulum, but it is activated by N-ethylmalleamide. Acrolein, exactly the same. Acrolein activates the glutathione S-transferase. If you, for example, first conjugate acrolein with glutathione, yeah, then acrolein cannot activate anymore. But by itself, these compounds activate their own detoxifying system. Isn't that a nice example? Is that interesting, Jaap? Not only rapid inhibition by these reactive metabolites of their own formation, but also, in addition to that, activation of the detoxification via activation of a microsomal glutathione S-transferase. Isn't that a beautiful example?
I think I see sort of the bigger picture evolving here. But I think we're not done yet, I guess. Because if these adaptation processes are really important, and we still disagree perhaps on the time frame, would that change the time-honored definition of health? Let us take a look at this. This is the 1946 definition, just after the Second World War. It seems a very static, a very elaborate, very grand idea of what health, in fact, is. But that doesn't really match up, I think, with what we're just discussing here now. Because if we sort of take a look at what we just have said, then this picture seems overly static, so to speak. So do we need to look at health another way? And I just shut up a few words which might give an indication of that. These are sort of circumventing words which we try to sort of capture the idea of what health might be. Metabolic flexibility, heterostasis, enhance homeostasis, improve metabolic health, resilience, optimize. These are words which might better reflect the discussion we have. So the question we might actually subsequently ask ourselves is it possible to improve health in healthy people? And how would we define healthy people in that particular sense? Because we have these flexible terms. And of course, this is the image we could actually use, like the spring coil. Health is the ability to adapt. We can compress, we can extend. And it seems to be the case that this probably defines a much better way of what we've discussed so far than this very static exposure, this static definition of health. So, Al, these adaptation processes will not influence the way we think about our health, but it will also affect our evaluations on chemical risks. And let me refer to your own research here, which you've done very recently, on acrolein and how that the response you see in this case to bronchial epithelial cells. Some time issues here. Now take, for instance, the 3 micromolar acrolein and how that responds to glutathione. Obviously, you see the immediate response, the immediate reaction goes down, and then it slowly goes up again as a response to the acrolein exposure. But take a look at the 10 micromolar concentration. You suddenly see the same dip, as you would expect, chemical reactivity, but you see sort of an uptake of the presence by a much higher degree than the 3 micromolar levels. We go down, now we look at the enzyme involved here, you see that the baseline with 3 micromolars is 1, and it goes up once the time goes on, which you might expect by the generation of the glutathione. But look at the 10 micromolars, you see actually a bigger increase of that expression. Now we're getting somewhere, I think. Next slide, please. Because here you can actually see if we have a baseline, we add 3 micromolars, you have a certain cytotoxicity. 10, of course, will give a bigger cytotoxicity. But the moment we sort of precondition with 3 micromolars and then add the 10 micromolars, you see a much lower cytotoxicity. Adaptation, an adaptive response. And the same here with GSH. You see at the 0 year baseline, you see a reduction, 3 in the 10 micromolars. And with the preconditioning of the 3 micromolars, you see a much higher response after the 10 micromolars. So Aalt, what you've done in your own research is already giving a good idea of chemical reactivity and the longer time frame response of, in this case, acrolein. Next slide. And this, I think, your own work might actually change our view on risk evaluation. And also, would that change our risk evaluations of foods? What do you think, Aalt?
Of course, we take a lot of food, and also you might regard some of the compounds even also as toxic in food. Take, for example, all the polyphenols that we have in food, compounds that are highly debated at the moment because of their health benefit. But in fact, some of these compounds can also be regarded as toxic. Take, for example, quercetin, compounds in apples, onions, grapes, or catechins, present in tea. Cocoa, for example, these polyphenols are active and they have an antioxidant action. We ourselves did quite some work on this compound, 7-monohydroxyethylrutoside, also polyphenol, phenolic structures in this compound. This compound is used in the treatment of chronic venous insufficiency, and we ourselves did quite some research to see whether this compound could prevent and could protect against the toxicity of certain anti-tumor agents, and it is effective in that respect. If you look to the compound, you see that monohair itself has some activity. It disappeared a little bit from the slide, but monohair itself has an antioxidant action indicated in this slide. Monohair is indeed an antioxidant. But if you give, for example, hydrogen peroxide itself, hydrogen peroxide, if you pre-treat cells, endothelial cells, with hydrogen peroxide, you see an adaptation towards intracellular oxidative damage by hydrogen peroxide pretreatment. And if you say the adaptation of hydrogen peroxide is, let's say, 100%, so that is the standard, then monohair itself does not lead to an adaptation. But strangely enough, if you combine hydrogen peroxide together with this flavonoid, monohair, still you see this adaptive response towards hydrogen peroxide. So the combination monohair and antioxidant, it protects against hydrogen peroxide. In combination with hydrogen peroxide, still gives this adaptive protective response. That is strange. In our opinion, it was strange. You have given antioxidant, it acts as an antioxidant, and at the same time, still there is an adaptive response, although hydrogen peroxide is taken away and the effect of hydrogen peroxide is taken away. What happens? Well, we thought at that time it could be that monohair is in fact oxidized by hydrogen peroxide. It acts as an antioxidant, so it gives an oxidized metabolite. And the oxidized metabolite is this quinone structure of monohair. This quinone structure is at the same time, again, thiol reactive. So you get a reactive metabolite out of this food constituent, monohair. What is happening with this activated kinone structure of monoher. Well, we know that there is endogenous protection in cells by this system, the NRF2 system. Normally, the NRF2 is kept by the keep system, then it is not active. At the moment keep comes off, out of the NRF2, this transcription factor, this transcription factor, NRF2, translocates into the nucleus, activates the DNA, and all kinds of cytoprotective enzymes, heme oxygenase, but also your enzyme, your glutathione synthesizing enzyme, gamma glutamyl cysteine synthase, this enzyme is also activated by NRF2. So the moment you take off the keep by means of thiol reactive compounds, for example the acrolein, but also, for example, a compound like monoher quinone, so the reactive metabolite of monoher, your NRF2 is activated, which leads to activation of cytoprotective enzymes. Now, in effect, you see that exactly. If you see hydrogen peroxide itself in cells, also endothelial cells, hydrogen peroxide leads to activation of heme oxygenase. And that reflects activation of NRF2. Different concentrations of hydrogen peroxide leads to activation of heme oxygenase. But also monoher in combination with hydrogen peroxide still leads to an activation of the NRF2 system, which is reflected in an activation of heme oxygenase. Not only heme oxygenase, but also thioreactive compounds, also activation of glutathione and glutathione synthesizing enzyme. The proof is clear, because we even were able to find this keep adduct of the activated monoher. This is the mass spectrum of normal keep. And if you then, now monoher in combination with hydrogen peroxide, activated monoher, you see the adduct of the activated, the oxidized monoher, the quinone structure, towards the keep. So in fact, we were able to see the adduct of the monoher quinone, the activated metabolite, towards the keep. So it is activated. And indeed, even you find in the cells, so the proof is very convincing. You find in the cells, in the nucleus, the NRF2. So if you find nuclear NRF2, you see that the combination monoher together with hydrogen peroxide, you see NRF2 in the nucleus. Also only with hydrogen peroxide, you see activation of NRF2 and you find it in the nucleus. So the proof is quite clear. It is an activating system. So in fact, what we see here, we see that if you have oxidative stress by itself, reactive oxygen species by themselves leads to toxicity, aselective toxicity, because hydrogen peroxide, reactive oxygen species, damage the keep, the thiol groups of the keep. NRF2 becomes activated because keep comes loose. NRF2 is activated, goes to the nucleus, and there it leads to an adaptive protection. But interestingly, with flavonoids, polyphenols in our food, these polyphenols first protect against the oxidative stress. That is the first protection. But as a result of that, these polyphenols then lead to a quinone structure. The phenols are protective. They are oxidized. These oxidized polyphenols then lead, these are thiol reactive compounds. They bind to the keep, to the thiol groups of the keep protein. NRF2 becomes activated, translocates into the nucleus, and leads to an adaptive response. Exactly. Isn't that beautiful?
That's exactly the same then.
Here you see that is toxicity here. And here you see an activation by means of a metabolite of a protective flavonoid. Isn't that beautiful? Do you see what I mean? Not only reactive chemicals will lead to adaptation, but even health effects of fruit and vegetables are none other than a toxic adaptive response. Fruit and vegetables are toxic, but the toxic response is in fact the protective response. Isn't that beautiful?
I really checked you off with my pushing you towards the results you have in your own laboratory, which is a good thing. Next slide, please. As far as I can see, I see two things here. The first one is, you explained elegantly, is reactive metabolites are responsible for their own demise by blocking their own formation, which is, of course, a good thing, because these reactive metabolites are not the stuff you want around. Above and beyond this, time-dependently, cell metabolites activate endogenous protective systems, you've shown quite expressly. And the latter is, in fact, an adaptive response regarded as improved health. Aalt.
Ah, dus the fast chemical adaptivity I talked about initiates the more slow adaptation you focused on. Yeah, so we talked about the very same thing from a different perspective. As a result, health by adaptation is none other than resilience against a toxic environment over different time frames. The toxic environment we have incorporated to our benefit in this way, that is beautiful. Yes. The two worlds that we have been separated for the past decades coalesce. The toxic and the beneficial are two sides of the same coin. Is that not beautiful? And here time seems to express two aspects. First, our physiology, time dependently on multiple scales, multiple time scales, copes with the toxic insults that are used for our own benefit. Secondly, time is of the essence to develop this concept further within pharmacology and toxicology. That is a beautiful conclusion. So after all, we agree. The time scales are different.
Have we ever disagreed, Aalt, over the last 15 years?
I think we have, and now it is time to end this this lecture. Thank you very much for your attention.
When the reactive metabolites are formed, this is, well, the normal chemical time scale. That's perhaps a microsecond. It's very fast. The moment the compound is generated, you have immediately a covalent bond forming between the enzyme and the product form. So that's lightning fast, so to speak. The second one, I'm not quite sure, but that will take a longer time to actually develop, because that has a whole biological pathway towards actually the adaptive response.
And in cells, we need several hours before it is just the activation of protein synthesis, of course. So if you want to increase your glutathione levels in cells, you have to activate the NRF2 pathway, you have to activate the glutathione synthesizing enzyme. So there's a whole protein synthesis that comes up, so that it's a matter of hours before that happens. That is indeed a much longer time scale. I fully agree with you. For example, formaldehyde, you mentioned formaldehyde. You can find formaldehyde in pears, for example. Hydrogen peroxide is present in cherry tomatoes. So these compounds are normal constituents of food. And interestingly, these compounds activate our own endogenous system. And indeed, we very strongly feel that the health benefit, and especially those compounds that are regarded as health beneficial compounds, are in fact compounds that challenge the system. And that is the reason they have a health benefit. Not just because they are direct antioxidants. No, because they are bioactive compounds that activate our own system. And that is how these food constituents, how these, all these healthy food-derived compounds act in our system. Yeah. But it's difficult to convey this message to the general public. That is a difficult message that we have to get here.
Not just pears, it's the human body.
Yep.
How does this impact thinking when people go to the supermarket and they think about buying organic and non-organic food? I mean, so in other words, some of the less healthy food sources, is that also a good thing then, to not get too clean, not get too organic?
What we're trying to say is here that we have lived in a world for a very long time where we have toxic and healthy. What we try to show here, I think Aalt research is an example of that, that these worlds are actually figments of our imagination. They're actually one and the same thing. So when Aalt discussed about antioxidants, we actually discussed an adaptive process which we might regard, if we look at it in the old school way, as toxic. But we seem to require that in order to actually increase our health. So we have to sort of coalesce these two worlds. We have sort of devised in our minds as sort of an orderly way of looking at the world. Whereas in reality, they're one and the same thing. That's why I sort of, between brackets, I said B450 uses oxygen toxicity to actually detoxify. Not always successful, but that's sort of the general process. So these walls actually one, not two. That's what we try to do here.
I'm so happy that I'm head of the department of pharmacology and toxicology. That makes me very happy because that gives room, that gives space for writing these things. Because it is indeed two, as we said, two sides of the same coin. There is no real difference between the two, toxicology and pharmacology, for example, or even physiology and toxicology. There is no difference between the two. These are that is a continuous system, and that is very important to realize. And even scientists do not, in our opinion, do not realize that to the full extent. That is all the same.
I agree on that. Yeah.
Don't oxygen radicals act differently in a high oxygen state than in a low oxygen state?
Do they act more in a high oxygen state? That is
differently.
Yeah, we know, for example, oxygen is a beautiful example with regard to the adaptive response, for example. If you have oxygen or oxygen radicals are very active in activating endogenous antioxidant systems. If you have, for example, superoxide radicals, O2 minus, oxygen with one additional electron, they are very strong inducers of protective enzymes like SOD, superoxide dismutase, the enzyme that detoxifies the superoxide radicals. So they are very active in that respect. High oxygen levels will lead also to more reactive oxygen species in most instances. At the same time, high oxygen levels may also, therefore, also have more protective activation of an induction of more activating system. Absolutely, yeah. Because that will lead to more reactive oxygen species. Oxygen tension is involved and is responsible all for and changing the level of reactive oxygen species. Absolutely, yeah.